Good morning, Twitch.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. We need a hoodie. And I'm gonna go get our drink for the stream. Where'd I put that hoodie? Bruh. Oh, that's a hoodie. Good morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good morning, after work tech, good morning. Hey, look.
If you all behave, we got a drug test.
But we'll see. You know, that can always be for a later stream thing, you know? It doesn't have to be this stream. We'll see if I have to pee. If I have to pee, I think maybe we can take the drug test. Double fisting of some drinks. We got a lemon spindrift here. We got a recess jumpy. Thank you for subscribing. We got the hoodie on. We got some tights. I really should have showered before this stream. Should we all just take a break while I go shower? What do y'all think about that? Kind of want to shower. I love pineapple spindrift. It's my absolute favorite. Yeah, no. We might want to shower. I feel a little gross. Yeah. All right. This test for amphetamine. Street names: speed, jelly beans or super jellies, hearts, uppers, pick me ups or wake me ups, wake ups, get ups, boot ups, and sparkles. Wow, this test for a lot of drugs, man. Key to clean. No, I think we got a shower, man. I think we got a shower. Well, I'm gonna probably test positive for marijuana. You know, I do partake in the marijuana occasionally. So, if you can't test positive for weed, I don't think my piss is gonna help you out, man. But, what drugs y'all think I'm on? You think I'm on amphetamine? I'm not gonna test positive for that. Oh, we're definitely going to sub-only chat. No, maybe it's just, I feel like we got a shower. I feel dirty, man. Oh my God. You know, you think Satoshi is a single person. Like, that's why we have sub-only chat, bro. That's why we have sub-only chat. All right. No hoodie. Let's, should we start with a little, guitar music? Wait, we don't need subscriber-only chat yet for shit-talking and guitar time. All right. Now that we did some nice guitar playing, we can get into the stream. Thank you for the hype train. Hope everyone liked our guitar playing. All right. I heard your guitar skills are as good as your pussy eating skills. All right, we're definitely going to subscriber only chat now. Bro, I don't know if that's a compliment or not. But either way,
All right. Thank you for subscribing. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. So for those of you who don't know, this is tinygrad. I just merged in a big thing this morning that makes tinygrad lazy. So let me take you on a little tour and I'll show you how to use it. So maybe we'll do IPython 3. Oh yeah, that's nice, that's nice. All right, so we can create a tensor. Tensor is not defined. Well, that's because we have to import tensor. Okay, now we can create an iTensor. All right, so an I is like this. Now, you see that tinygrad now is in lazy mode all the time. So if we want to actually take a look at that tensor, we can do x.numpy, and there we go, we can look at it. Right? Let's make a little graph. So create a tensor, create this iTensor, which remember an iTensor is just that. Here we go, we'll create another tensor. Look at that tensor too. That. We're gonna multiply, we're gonna do matmul, do a backward pass. And we'll take a look at the gradient. We gotta do numpy if we wanna actually look at it. So here we go, that's the gradient, right? So now I can exit, and you can see that we saved a graph. There we go. So, a few things to note here is that this 1, 3 is this. This 3, 3 is this. The green ones are all reshapes and stuff. And then this one here is a convolution because a matrix multiply and a convolution are actually the same thing. So this is the we didn't actually take a look at Z, but when we summed it, this is the actual shape here, and that's the shape down there. Now, does everyone kind of understand that? Let's do a simple one. Okay, so we'll say X equals tensor. Let me just add a little. So we already have tensor. Okay, so we can say tensor dot I 10. Beautiful, look at that. Actually, should we fix that just to resolve? It's kind of useless if we just print that. Yeah, let's add a little bit of code for that. Where'd my tinygrad go? Tinygrad. So here we can say lazy data if self.lazyData.resolved is none else self.lazyData.resolved. So you can look here. Well, we'll do a more proper tour in a minute, but let's just take a look and see if that change had the intended effect. Lazy buffer has no attribute resolved. What did I call it? Realized. Oh, it's not resolved. It's realized. I should have known because it didn't light up green. Man, I love VS Code. Right. Good. Okay. Now it's a lot more reasonable. You can see that it's actually an underlying CPU buffer. But if we switch tinygrad here to lazy mode, we're just going to see a big lazy buffer. All right, cool. Print underlying buffer if. Okay, now, look, I know that some of you, I saw a comment once where you guys are like, oh, George just does these streams of projects he's been working on for a long time. But then I get the opposite complaint, which is, you know, George just does these one-off projects that he never comes back to. So, you know, that just proves that there's two armies of haters in the world. And I don't know, but print underline buffer if it's realized. I gotta be better about my its and it, so that actually is an it is, so I should use the apostrophe. But for possessive, you don't use the thing. Okay. So let's look at something simple here. All right, so we're just gonna take these two 10 by 10 matrices and we're gonna multiply them together. There we go. And of course, an identity matrix times an identity matrix is another identity matrix. So we can look at the graph that was actually used here, and that's a lot simpler, right? So we had two matrices and put together. All right, now of course, tinygrad also supports the GPU. So we could say GPU equals one. And then when we look, it just says GPU buffer. We'll do the same thing here. Now, we don't have to look at the output. When I look here, you see these dashes? These are dashed because it's not a contiguous tensor. So this brings us to one of the first, well, it's a tour through tinygrad, so we're actually gonna, you know, do a tour here. So this is the tinygrad codebase, and here's something to notice. Okay, so tinygrad has three backends, CPU, GPU, and torch. It's lazy. Now, does everyone know what laziness means? So it's lazy if you set lazy equal to one. And that was just merged this morning, but I've been working on it for a while. So what lazy means is that if you, yeah, let's run it with lazy mode, I can show you. So, if I have, let's create a tensor of a list, you know, 1, 2, 3. We'll create another tensor, 4, 5, 6, right? So does everyone know what x plus y is? Well, x plus y creates a tensor, but there's a question. Do we actually want to resolve x plus y? Let's say z equals x plus y, right? So if you're running in non-lazy mode, x and y are actually like underlying their CPU buffers because CPU is the default device. So if I type x plus y, it actually computes the sum of x plus y. Oh yeah, so yeah, I guess okay. Well, we'll zoom out. We're going on a tour, but what is tinygrad? Well, tinygrad is a tensor library. What is a tensor? A tensor is a list of numbers. So does everyone like understand what that does? Everyone understand like does x, y plus sum, right? Great, that's good, right? All machine learning is pretty much just this stuff. You also have to be able to compute the derivatives. All right, so you can take the derivative, so we can say something like x dot y dot mean dot backward. And now we can look at the gradients. Why those are the gradients, who cares, man? Just do it right, and I just tested it. I don't know, man. That would involve knowing calculus, and I don't really know any calculus. Okay, so what's the point of, so let's do it lazy now. By the way, we can look at the graph of what we did, and it looks like this. So we added two numbers together, and then we did the backwards pass here, and that's what got us the gradient here. Okay. So what is the benefit of laziness? Well, laziness means that you don't actually do the operation until it's requested. So actually, maybe if we want to look at the difference, we should get some really big tensors. All right, so let's make some really big matrices here. Let's say 2048, 2048. Now if I do, well, never mind, that's just blazingly fast. Okay, well, gotta go bigger. All
There we go. That's slow now. Okay? So that's multiplying two 8K matrices by each other, and it takes some amount of time, right? What lazy means is that you save the operations till the absolute last minute. So it's not until you're actually looking at what the output is you even bother to compute it. So you can look up laziness. Laziness is an absolutely common thing in programming languages. Like Haskell is a lazy language. So if I go in here and do NumPy, you see now it actually takes the time, not before. So you ask, okay, why does this matter? Why does it matter when you actually do the computation? Well, if you're doing something like A plus B, but you never actually use the output of A plus B, all you really do is this, A plus B plus C. There's no reason to actually save A plus B into a buffer. You can just append it and then add C later, and you never have to compute that intermediary. Oh, wow, you can see the stream lag when I execute the command.
Oh, that's funny. That's funny. I think the main reason I wanted to shower is this hoodie needs to be washed. Which hoodie should we wear? This hoodie? This hoodie clean? That hoodie smells pretty clean. Got a nice clean hoodie. Oh man, I got new clothes in the washing machine.
Alright, so what can you actually do with tinygrad? This is a popular one here. So I have some examples here. We can do this one. So examples, efficient net. So it downloads a picture of a hen and it does inference on it. Or let's see, does the webcam one still work? What are the odds this works? Oh, here we go. Okay, it's using my other webcam. Let's take this remote and see. There we go, remote control, right? All right, cool. Let's see what it thinks my drug test is. Oh, it just sees the microphone. Look at that. That's pretty cool, right? Yeah, so we're using the webcam. Oh, did the stream get crappy? Oh, it's because it's using... Oh, wow. Okay. Well, that's what happens when you use NumPy. But if we put on the GPU, we shouldn't have these problems. Let's say GPU equals 1. Is that better? Yeah, okay. Now we're running the thing on the GPU instead of the CPU. So you can remember my test here. Look, I hold up the remote control. It says remote control. That's great. Sees the mic. Let's see what thinks my spin drift is. Oh, it's a thimble. Oh, lotion. I see where it's coming from. What else we got? We got some keys. Oh, it's laggy. I don't know what to tell you. Oh, now it's fine. All right, cool. So we're running this on the GPU right now. We're running... what does it think the recess is? Hairspray. Oh, pretty close. It doesn't know about soda, but it's good at remote control. And it's good at mic. Let's cover the mic and see. Oh, yeah. Oh, it knows about a mouse. See some headphones. Does it know about headphones? Neck brace. All right, that's pretty reasonable. Well, yeah, the code is using a ton of CPU resources. Let's see if we say lazy equals 1. If that makes it, if that changes anything. No, it doesn't really change anything. All right, cool. Except that it's gotta go through all those realizes. The webcam's laggy. Well, it's not laggy, it's just, it's running the net. Right? It's doing inference on the net. So tinygrad is a tensor library that can be used to implement neural networks very similar to PyTorch, except it's a lot simpler than PyTorch because it's only 992 lines.
Kind of my philosophy with this stuff is that neural network libraries don't have to be big and complex at all. And if they are big and complex, you're doing something wrong.
So we can talk about how this stuff actually works. Maybe we start with the Tensor class. So this is the Tensor class here. You can init, you can create it from data. Your data can be a list. I just use NumPy to turn that into a thing. Your data can be another lazy buffer. If it's on a different device, we just take it to the CPU. And then if it's actually still a NumPy array, we use this from CPU operator to create the underlying lazy data. So this is like the data that underlies, this lazy data is the data that underlies the tensor. So PyTorch and NumPy both have something similar. It's called .data. Now, tensors also have gradients, and you can keep a context around in order to compute that gradient. So these are the data handlers. Realize actually realizes the lazy buffer if you're using it in lazy mode. Assign, let's see, like assign a tensor, detach, same as PyTorch, NumPy converts it to NumPy. Data is the same, that data is the same thing as NumPy, it's just kind of legacy behavior. Two, same as PyTorch. Here are the creation methods. So you can create a tensor from zeros, ones, random numbers, arrange, uniform randomness, or the I one. There's just some creation helpers you might want to use. You can also pass in you can also just pass in a list like I showed you. Let's just handle it up here. Okay, cool. So this stuff is the automatic differentiation engine. So you do this, you topologically sort all the nodes. If you don't know what that is, Google it. You topo sort in the graph, and then this actually computes the gradients here. You make the first gradient one. If you're at the end and you have, that's just how it's called implicit gradient creation. I don't know. I copied that from Carpathy. This is like, he had this project MicroGrad that was like tinygrad, but like not actually practical because it used Python as the backend for everything. So we use practical backends. Tinygrad is a little bit bigger than a MicroGrad. Most of the math is through NumPy itself. No. It has three backends. You can use NumPy, a custom GPU backend, or Torch. And there's also various supports for all sorts of backends, TPUs, ANEs. One of the TinyGrad things that I'm working on here, you see OpenPilot's in here. TinyGrad's gonna start to compile the OpenPilot model. It already does. It's already doing a better job than the Qualcomm library. It's just not as, I optimized the Qualcomm library. My optimized version is a little bit faster still, but we'll beat it soon. Yes, the 990 lines of code include all three backends. They do. We'll go. It's a tour. It's not that many lines to read. I'm only reading. So this is the automatic differentiation engine, and these are HLOps. So it supports things like getItem. Wait. That's not good. Okay, we're gonna fix that. It doesn't support a single slice like that right now. Oh, that's a bad bug. All right, whatever. You see the problem now. It's cute. So we can like slice the tensor. Get a one, get a two. And the problem is that tensor doesn't have a shape, and that's what it's complaining about. That should be fixed. If someone wants to submit a pull request to fix that, but you get what it's supposed to do. Okay. I never actually used tinygrad like this. Like, you almost never write something like that in a tensor library. But of course you do that for an array all the time. Yeah, it's pretty terrible. Should we try to fix that? Should we fix that bug? Let's fix that bug. Let's fix that bug and then we'll resume with the tour. The problem is tinygrad doesn't support tensors without shape. So you see this shape here is just that. That should never really be called. Let me put it here. If shape equals tuple, if length shape equals zero, shape equals tinygrad doesn't support empty shapes. Okay, so everything was pretty much behaving well, but the problem was that when you have a one-dimensional thing, it's unclear if the shape is an empty tuple. Len zero shapes. I actually have another hack for that. Probably the right place to put it, though. Should we look higher up into where that reshape actually is getting called? In get item. Maybe that's the better place to fix it. Yeah, it's probably the better place to fix it. Okay. If new shape, length new shape equals zero, new shape equals one. Tinygrad doesn't support shapes. We'll fix in the HLR. That's a better place to fix it. I think that's only an issue in get item. Okay. So this brings us to what HLOps are. HLOps are like the highest level operations, and they operate on tensors themselves. So these are methods on the tensor class. There's a bunch of layers of abstraction here. It all fits in 1,000 lines and it's kind of hard to keep straight. So remember there's HLOps, MLOps, and LLOps. So HLOps apply to the tensor class. And HLOps don't have to worry about differentiation. The differentiation's all dealt with at the MLOp level. So you see, okay, get item, cat, you can use cat, So we can do like x.catx. And 123, 123. All right, cool. That works pretty well. I should probably create a test for what broke too. Do I have any tests for get item? It's good practice when something breaks to add a test. Actually, we should really confirm that that test didn't work before. So, yep, see the test fails? This is good software development practices. If you pay attention, you'll learn things, right? Now we made a test that makes sure that behavior never regresses again, because if you break something, you're likely to break it again. So you see x.catx. You can also, I believe, say like cat xxxxx. Okay, good. Great, that works. Pad2d. Oh, here's a fun thing you can do in tinygrad. So if I do something like this, see that it adds zeros. This has a different meaning in like pretty much every other library, but I don't really think that they do that correctly. I think that a lot of times when you're slicing outside the thing, right, you're like, you can slice, you know, inside the thing, but I can also slice outside the thing and I get zeros. Okay, check the shape, the tensor, it's 9. I've never really used tinygrad like this before, so we're gonna find some bugs. Maybe. So pad2d is just syntactic sugar around that, does the same as PyTorch's pad2d. This is matmul. You'll see something to note about matmul is that we treat matmul the same as a convolution with this shape. So you can treat all matmuls as convolutions on one by one images. Actually, it's not totally one by one. Would you guys like to see me write the shapes out of the matmul? It's right, I have tons of tests for this. I guess I kind of just did this and then didn't really comment it. It doesn't really matter. It's straightforward enough. I'll just add a note here. Note. We use a convolution to do the matmul. Inner dimension is cn. Yeah. So when you think of a matmul, it's like if you have m by k times k by n, right, equals so we can work out the dimensionality of this. One, so the in we're using NCHW format for the convolution. So we have something like that as the input, and then for the weights we have NK11 because it's a 1x1 convolution. So we use a 1x1 conv2d. All right, does this make sense? Use a 1x1 conv2d to do the matmul. So this is like, it's just the x dimension here. We don't have any batch, and the weights are here. And then weights are c out, c in, hw. So our channels in match, and then our channels out are in. Cool. So what's the difference between a dot and a mat mall? I don't know. I set them to the same thing. You can also, there's a bunch more trickery here because you can do groups and batches. So you can do a batch mat mall, which is just like a normal batch mat mall, but you can also apply different weights to each one. That's a group mat mall. It's the same as a group convolution. Can you do different types of padding? You can just do zeros. Why? You want something that's not zeros? You only get zeros. This op's a little annoying, and I might change it. All right, so we can do a transpose. So let's make a little matrix here. Tensor. Let's just do 1, 2, 3, 4. Call it M because it's a matrix. And a matrix, so we can transpose the matrix. And you see that it move flips the 2 and 3. Pretty straightforward. We can flatten the matrix. Cool, flattens. We can sum the matrix. And you see, like, if I do m.sum or if I do m.flatten.sum, it's the same thing. m.mean, what's the mean of 1, 2, 3, and 4? 2.5? 2.5, look at that. We can, of course, select that 2.5. And we get the same thing because we don't support. Great. Softmax, dropout, pools, the conv operation itself. We also support a bias here, which we add to the channels. Unary math functions, unary activation functions, all the activation functions that are used in neural networks. Now, binary ops are a little bit different. So here's a fun thing to note about binary ops. So let's go back to my X tensor here. Let's create a Y tensor. And the Y tensor is just 6. Okay. I have a Y tensor called 6. So what's this times this? Can you do it? And you can. The Y is broadcasted. So this 6 is broadcasted across these axes. So it took a really long time to get broadcasting correct. But I think it's pretty correct. Now, how are we doing on viewers? Oh, I gotta pee. Should I take my drug test? No, you guys don't deserve it, you know? I'll let you all sit and wonder if I'm on drugs, man. By the way, I can demonstrate some of these activation functions. You can do like an LU. LU is not gonna do anything there, but like a sigmoid's gonna do something. All right, cool. But yeah, so that's x times y. 620, yeah, not too bad. This is like tinygrad is one of the best things I've ever written, guys. So it's broadcasting this 6 here. Now, you know, you can do other things too, like 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So what does it look like if I multiply m by y? Well, m by y does exactly what you think, but I can also create a z tensor, which let's say it's minus 1, 1. Right, what's m times z? Well, the first one is multiplied by the minus 1, and the second one is multiplied by the 1. So it took a long time to get broadcasting correct, but got it correct. And then you can even support not multiplying it by a tensor. I can do something like 4 times m, or m times 4. Of course, multiplication is commutative. That's pretty good. Oh, no, tinygrad is, tinygrad can do everything. So here's a fun thing to know. Div is not actually, so, you know, we can divide here, but it doesn't actually use div. Div is really the same thing as just saying m times 2 to the power of minus 1. So those work out to the same thing.
we're just getting started with tinygrad.
Okay, so we have some neural network ops. We can do reshapes. You already saw reshape pretty much, but we can like reshape this into four. Maybe put a couple ones on it. Whoops. Yeah. All right. Cool. Expand. So. Let's reshape it to 4x1. Right, and then let's expand it to 4x4. You'll see that it just copies out to 4. So we expand that to 100. Right. So this expand is the key thing underlying broadcast. It expands it. Now you say, oh, but that's gonna be slow. Well, not really. And broadcasting is doing that virtually. But all of these things still have the same underlying memory as this one. And you can do that by setting your strides to 0. So we'll get into what strides are in a minute. If you don't know. Okay. Cool. So those are the rest of the... And linear is just syntactic sugar around... what is that crap? Okay. You can do linear layers. Sequential. It's just a reduce thing. Actually, should I just write that in terms of func tools reduce? I probably should. Do I have a test for sequential? Kind of any test for sequential. If efficient net breaks. Meh. I have to think too hard to write it as reduce, so we'll just leave it as that for now. Let's write it as reduce. Okay. Function. Apply a function of two arguments cumulatively to a sequence. So you can say x, comma f, f sub x, ll self. So that's a cuter way to just write that. Like, I hated that for loop. I thought that looked terrible. So it's returning that. It's iterating over LL. It starts with self, and it returns stuff. So that's a cuter way to write that. It's not slower, is it? No. Sometimes you get lucky. Sometimes you get unlucky. It's slower the first time on the GPU because it has to compile CL kernels. Okay, that's a good fix to sequential. It's cute. We should probably get a test for it. We have a good place to test that. Yeah. Okay. Instantiation of the function is the context. This is when you actually apply something. This is what makes the auto gradient engine work. Do I use parents anywhere? Yeah, I use it down here in the backwards pass. Okay, cool. I probably don't want to save the parents if it doesn't require the gradient. No, okay. Now this will go out of scope actually really quickly. It gets created down here in apply, and then apply is run here when you actually dispatch the MLOP operation. Okay, so what's an MLOP? So these are HLOPs. These are all operations that can apply to tensors. They're written very high level, like, you know, beautiful high level stuff. Okay. Now we get to MLOPs. MLOPs are where the derivatives are actually implemented. So you'll see for each of the MLOPs, and there's a pretty short list of them, ReLU, log, x, sum, max, add, sub, mul, pow, we don't have div, expand, reshape, permute, slice, these are movement ops, and then processing ops, we only have a convolution. So this is where I computed all of the gradients, and this is, I'm gonna look cleaner if I, I'm gonna do some cleanup here. I write it in this style where I don't, but then it just looks like confusing, I think. So you see, here's the unary op. It's just a generic unary op. I subclass it a little to save a bit of space. If you have like the just absolutely generic one, maybe I shouldn't. That actually looks terrible. Let me get rid of that. Makes it harder to read. Then I have a set of really good tests that I just run whenever I make changes, make sure I didn't break anything. Sorry, I'll run them on the GPU so it doesn't lag. Probably lags the stream if I do CPU. Cool. I'm gonna keep refactoring that. You see how I just like moved it into like, instead of having this very explicit, this one upsets me. Because this one I actually don't, it's not a tensor that I save, it's the input shape. I can do this, right? Be a nicer way to write this. I don't really like that it assigns arbitrary properties, but I also don't like that it's not an actual tensor being saved there. Is that the only place I don't save a tensor? When we do a sum here, we have to save the shape. Because it has to know what shape to bring back. So like this is what's the derivative of a sum? Well, the derivative of a sum is an expand. And it says forward, backwards. This is should be clear to everybody who like knows PyTorch. Save for backward. Added sub, you don't have to save the tensors for backwards. I don't really know why. cool. Again, here we save the shape. So I'm just gonna use the same syntax I use here. So if you look at expand, it's actually the opposite of sum. Put a little note there because I thought it was cute. Oh, that's a bug. Did I write input? Do I call it input there? I call it input there. I don't call it X. Yeah. Maybe I can make input shape a special property that automatically gets populated. So permute, just do an arg sort on the input order, and that's the derivative of permute. Oh, here we save both the shape and the arg. That's terrible. Do I really have to do that? I don't need the shape, if I think about it. First, make sure tests are still passing. Cool. So this is the convolution here. And one of the things I'm most proud of here is these are the derivatives of convolution implemented as convolutions. So aside from this little hack here, where you have to deal with strides, it's very clean to actually implement the convolution as the derivative of convolutions as convolutions. So actually, I guess what I haven't really talked about here is what these things are: unary op, binary op, movement op, and processing op and reduce op. These are the LL ops. So ML ops implement and care about derivatives, whereas LL ops don't. So LL ops don't have to think about, you know, if derivatives are correct or not. Let me think about what I did here and whether that's actually necessary. Can I just say negative P1? I don't think I can. Well, I know the grad output shape. So you know that the grad output shape is always the output shape of this thing. So if I know the shape here that it's going to actually compute, it depends on the input shape here. The grad output shape is, it's just P1.
since I do the zero filling like that in slice, so the derivative of slice is easy to implement. So okay, if you think about it, you have something coming in that's like 0:4, right? And you're slicing it to, let's say, 1:2. You want it to go back to 0:4. Can I change this to shape sub I minus P sub 0? I think I can. Does that make sense? Like, because we know that the output shape, remember slice is just taking in what the slice takes in what the new shape should be. Right? So like 1:2 is gonna slice out 1:2. We know the size of the thing has to be the same. So that's the way the size works out, the same. Cool. Then we can say something like context.nrg x.shape context.nrg. So nrg is like the inverting of the argument. Cool. It's a lot cleaner. Cells.access equals access. Cool. Sequential. What? Oh, the Wi-Fi's so bad here. Oh, I'm sorry about the laggy stream. Yeah, Wi-Fi sucks. Great. It's a tour through tinygrad. If you weren't here from the beginning, you gotta subscribe and then go back to the beginning and then you can look. Here's Tensor. Tensor here is the high-level operations, which like operate on tensors. Not don't worry about derivatives. It's autodiff. This is the ops for the mid-level ops, which compute the derivatives. Now, you ask, how does any of this stuff actually run on a device? And that's what we have LLOps for. So these things are all LLOps. You can see there's a list of them right here. No op. Do I use noob for anything? You should get rid of it. I think noob is stupid. I don't use noob, do I? I used it when like there were bugs. Oh. Yeah, okay, that kind of makes sense. Only needs to be supported on the GPU though.
Oh, there's too much. The Wi-Fi's too bad. All right, if it keeps dropping out, stream's over.
Can I open the door, maybe? I got a big wire.
So LLOps actually do the computation on the device. This is the GPU backend. You'll see it's pretty much the same stuff, although it's a bit harder to read. And this is the Torch backend. You'll see that most of the stuff just imports from CPU. And it just uses all the same stuff as NumPy. CPU is kind of poorly named. It's actually NumPy. So we might want to change that. But yeah, support NumPy, support GPU, which is a bunch of OpenCL kernels, and we support CPU. So now, we can do all sorts of stuff with this, like train efficient nets. TinyGrad's been around for a long time, and there's a lot of examples. Like, people have written all sorts of nets in it. It has an Onyx loader. So we'll see. It's saving right now. This is a forward pass of training an efficient net. I don't have the optim. I broke the optimizer when I merged in the lazy stuff. But here, we can go from one convolution to another convolution here. Let me move over so you guys can see. So this is the input convolution. This is batch normalization. This is the actual computation for the batch normalization. This is an LU, and then there's the next convolution. The reds are convolutions, blues are reduce ops, greens are movement ops. These are movement ops where it's non-contiguous. These are free movement ops. These are binary and unary ops, and the yellows are load ops. Yeah, so that's a tour through TinyGrad. If you want to add your own custom accelerator, you just have to support these. And you don't really have to support all of them. Oh yeah, there's one class I didn't talk about yet, and that's Shape Tracker. So Shape Tracker is where we actually... You can do a lot of these reshape, permute, flip, slice, expand, and stride. You can do a lot of these without by just changing the way you view the tensor, and this is what Shape Tracker does. No, it's all included. We also include three optimizers. Oh yeah, I forgot to talk about the optimizers. Well, this is high level stuff that people should be more familiar with. Stochastic gradient descent, RMS prop, and atom. We include three optimizers. We include a batch norm function, and we include a prettified convolution that matches PyTorch's. So these ones are the same thing as what PyTorch does. This is some helper functions. NumPy's prod is really slow, so we created our own prod. Actually, maybe it's just quicker to import math. Just change it to math prod in places. From math, import prod. Are we gonna work on Cherry anymore? Well, so, you know, I have this radical idea that if you're gonna build some hardware for neural nets, you should do the software first. If I can't make software that's competitive with PyTorch, how am I ever gonna make an accelerator? And I realized that when I was working on Cherry last time, like, I was so far away from anything that could possibly work and give any sort of speed and be competitive. If you can't build something that, like, runs really well on GPUs and then talk about exactly why it's slow and why your hardware is faster, you shouldn't be building hardware. That's the final takeaway from all my neural network stuff. The biggest thing that makes neural networks less than efficient is because of extra trips to memory. It's not compute that's expensive. It's data movement that's expensive. And your compute is also pretty fixed. The compute that you're doing is, you can't really change that. It's not that GPUs are doing, you're almost never hitting the maximum flop numbers on GPUs, especially with NVIDIA's Tensor cores. The thing that you're hitting is memory limitations. And your hardware is going to have memory limitations too, because the memory limitations are not a function of the GPU itself. GPUs have incredibly flexible, good memory architectures. In fact, your memory architecture on your device is likely to be much less flexible and good. So there's no reason that the only thing that makes GPUs slightly suboptimal for neural networks is, like, the fact that they have caches. But if you want to try to not have caches, you better have all your ML operations perfect. I bought this thing. So this is a rock chip. This is the reference manual for the ROC chip. And this is what their neural network accelerator looks like. Oh, the stream's broken. Well, like, it's pretty easy now if you want to replace NumPy. This is all the code that makes any references to NumPy, really. Except for, I like import NumPy in a few places that I just shouldn't. Why do I import NumPy here? Lazy, we actually don't have to worry about any of this anymore. This stuff shouldn't be a thing. Return the indices that would sort an array. you see what it is? So first let's... Still uses NumPy. We actually should. We should do a better job of that too.
Though shouldn't actually be.
Why would removing caches from the GPU improve performance? The problem with a cache is you're making you're doing data movement. You're doing a ton of data movement that a lot of times you don't have to do. You sort of need caches. They're implicitly managed instead of explicitly managed. So when you look here, like on this Rock Chip neural accelerator, they have a buffer here, and the buffer here is explicit. It's not a cache. Oh, here we go. Equivalent of NumPy, arg, sort, and basic Python. Does it use like sort and zip and stuff? Oh. Oh, that's really cute. Thank you. Comments don't add to line count. Neither do empty lines. Arg sort's not defined. Not save it? Wait, I'll get it. What? Ah. Well, we don't need that. Oh, it's gonna make stuff slightly faster too. NumPy sucks. That's incredibly clever. Do you see what it's doing there? Okay. How would you like... This is a noob stream. It's for noobs. We did a lot of noob stuff. Do you guys feel like you understand this code base now? I know this isn't the best tutorial, and I know that like I got distracted and fixed some bugs and did some extra stuff. We could talk about how the shape tracker works, but probably the best way to understand the shape tracker is to read the shape tracker tests. Tests are not included in the 1,000 lines, by the way. There's a whole lot of tests that are outside. All right, we're down to 979 lines.
Good. We have like, you know, it's like in solitaire when you get that empty column, you got space for a king.
Cool. We have tests for the optimizers. There is a function that I wanted to move in from extra. We use it in extra a lot. It's the one where we get parameters. Get parameter should probably go in the optimizer. You don't understand how to chain the autograd. This is the thing that does it. It basically just does this deep walk class, which is a topological sort. So topological sort means that if you have a graph, the parents in the graph are always above you. So we do the deep walk backwards, starting from this tensor. Reverse it, iterate through. This actually computes the derivative. This turns things into tensors. Sometimes you don't need the derivative, so that can be none. Little stupid hack here. You'll see that on the ML ops, some of them return 2, some of them return 1. If it returns 2, it's a list. If it returns 1, it's not. Nobody liked the tinygrad tour. I don't know, like I've read this code so much and like just when you think it can't get smaller, it gets smaller. Like here, there's some problem with kwarg, so I have to have these stupid helper classes, which can be removed as soon as I figure out what the problem is. It's probably like a one character fix, and then that can go away. Helpers to deal with that. Subscribers don't talk much. We should make self work. Let me do that. So what is that? This is a magic function in Python. Python, what is it called? Neg. Implement negation by overriding neg. I think I can just do this. Cool. Yeah, I mean, the README is kind of trash. I'm going to write a new README once things are actually done. And I'm going to talk about, like, my HLOps, MLOps. They used to be called, like, first-class ops and second-class ops and stuff. So, yeah, you can add, like, you look at things that you think are, like, really comp. Oh, yeah, oh, I have to support arbitrary strides in the pools. Oh, yeah, I forgot about that one. That's why a lot of the stuff doesn't work in, this is an Onyx loader. We should refactor out a lot of this. Oh, I guess I already put an extra, but we should put it in loaders. Well, we'll work on Tiny Voice once tinygrad's ready. Like, this is gonna train efficient nets on ImageNet, probably faster than PyTorch. I think it's actually gonna be faster than PyTorch when we're done. Yeah, I don't know. I don't have much else. So people can type import tinygrad. Do I care about that? Probably. It's probably some legacy behavior someone relies on who kind of uses this. Yeah, I mean, but like, it's because PyTorch isn't lazy. PyTorch is limited always in what it can do. If you write this in PyTorch and you don't use like their magical JIT stuff, it's actually writing A plus B out to memory and then computing C. Based on NumPy tensors. No, it's totally not based on NumPy tensors. So the only thing that's device specific is in the LLOps folder. So this is the one that's based on NumPy tensor. You see the NumPy tensor there. This is the one that's GPU. I track the buffer explicitly here. No, what do you mean? There's totally GPU support. Like, the GPU support is so transparent, you don't even see it. Yeah, you know what? I'll run with debug units too, so you can see. All of these are actually CL kernel launches. And I've gotten everything down to two CL kernels. There's the element-wise CL kernel, which includes a convolution. An optional convolution. And then there's the reduce CL kernel. Yeah, this is everything you basically need. It uses shape tracker in order to do all the other shapes. And that just gets shoved into an element-wise kernel. Yeah, so that's running an efficient net on GPU. You'll see if I use CPU, it doesn't have any of those kernel launches. Yeah, it's simple and memory efficient. Yeah, well, it's got to be memory efficient because if you're not lazy, it's really hard to make these things memory efficient. But then you also don't want to be like stupid TensorFlow where, oh, I'm going to construct a graph and then I'm going to run optimizers on it and it's going to take forever. I think laziness is the right compromise. And give me a bit more to really make the laziness good. But I think when it's good, and when I get the optimizer, so I have an optimizer before lazy, like I consider it like upstreamed. It was in here, just in like this trash folder. Here we have some optimizations. You know, you don't get this kind of simplicity. I've probably written 20,000 lines of code to get the 1,000 lines of code in tinygrad that I'm very happy with. Why don't I just go get hired by PyTorch? Oh God. So first off, do you mean Facebook? Second off, do you mean have to deal with all that shit?
It's not that tinygrad supports almost everything PyTorch does. Like, you show me something in PyTorch, and if you want to add it to tinygrad, like, if you can do it all with HLOps, you can do it all outside the library. If you need... There's probably a few... There's, like, little things that I don't support that we'd have to add support for. But we'll get there when it comes time. But, no, I mean, so tinygrad supports... here, you can go into models, efficient nets, transformer, visual transformer, and ResNet are kind of like the four main ones that I did. But yeah, so you can load, like, you can, and like, this is all just crap that just loads the thing, but you can load in big visual transformers. Why divide stuff? Well, because they do fundamentally different things. So this is the kind of stuff that should be in the README. MLOps care about derivatives, and LLOps care about what device you're actually running it on, and then HLOps just care about making things syntactically nice for users. Yeah, everything's compiled on the fly. I compile everything here using this. This is another thing you can do to make it fast. Tinygrad plus plus. What do you want in plus plus? I was working in tinygrad all morning. I just didn't want to stream it. I don't think you guys like the tinygrad streams. Like, you find when you get the refactored stuff, like, exactly right, you find that it doesn't, like, it just feels correct. You want a C++ API? Why? Python, forever. They're going to make Python fast, don't worry. You can see at the end here, this is how many ops it did to run that efficient net. So, off stream, I think I'm going to work on moving the optimizer over. Drug tests. I don't know. This wasn't a party stream. On a party stream, we'll do the drug test. Y'all can think I'm on drugs in the meantime. Implemented GPU kernels by hand. Well, like, when you get down to it, the GPU kernels are very, very simple. So you can read, like, it's not too many lines of code to just read. You want to add some typing? Does that sound like a fun thing to do? We can see if we can get this thing to type check in MyPy. This is my convolution. It has two optimizations in it, one by one and all valid. This is what implements padding. This is the convolution. Remember, since I've written the derivative of the convolution in terms of a convolution. All right, do I have MyPy on here? What does MyPy do if I just run it like that? Let's only type check the good stuff. That's actually gonna type check. Missing target package. All right, we have some bugs to fix. In shape tracker, can't determine types of views.
guess that is kind of annoying. Okay, so views are used inside the shape tracker. Attribute views already defined. You know what? I'm just going to write this like this. If you're coming from a shape tracker, otherwise you're coming from a tuple, and we create a new view over here. Okay, we need type annotation for counts. Oh, counts is stupid. What's CTX? Now, if I update it, sometimes you update things, bugs go away. Nope. Argument one to find buffer has incompatible type module expected device. Oh, are we gonna find bugs because of this? Understand that. What do I find to put out here? Name CPU is not defined. That's actually okay. We should say buffers sub CPU. What broke that? Is it find buffer? Oh, there shouldn't be a buffer, actually. It should be CPU, but look at this. Look, we do this hack here. Var subname. I really think I want to say device.getItemCPU. But there's no device yet. Code is ugly.
I don't like that code. Let's think about what it's doing. Let's write it better.
think I used that hack anywhere. Where do I get self.device? Have we done any benchmarks? Well, not really. I have to finish the optimizer before it'll really be faster. And then, like, what would you want to benchmark? The only thing that would really make sense to benchmark is there's some things that I'll already do way faster, because a lot of times in PyTorch, you're not limited by your GPU, you're limited by the Python launching the kernels. CUDA launch kernels is really slow. Well, let me fix this type error. So, like, it doesn't really make that much sense. The thing that you want, finally want to benchmark is the overall training speed of everything. Actually, just do that. Can I not? Cool. Tuple index out of range. How does it not? No, it's not an environment thing. That's right. Why does it think that tuple index is out of range? Oh. Is this really a tuple? Should be more like a list. Cannot resolve name lazy op. Possible cyclic definition. But yeah, that's why I from future import annotations. List tensor has no attribute device. Yeah, but it's not a list. What? I dereference the list. Function has no attribute forward. Well, yeah, because it's a subclass. We should fix that. We should probably write. Is these things are instantiations of this, but the base one's not going to have any thing. So that's not a real bug. Okay. None has no attribute shape. That's in ops. Oh, but optional. Oh, and now we need the other type. I call it device buffer. Here. is that actually what I mean when I say that? So maybe we don't actually want a list there. Maybe we do want a tuple, but I need this dot 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 syntax. Ah, that's better. And then we can fix that on shape tracker too. Okay, I just have my... It's not a tuple int is not like a list int. That means more of the same. I think I have the same problem in my lazy op constructor, yes. Okay. I don't know what to do about that. Argument 3 to lazy buffer has incompatible type. Type movement ops, expected union. Well, it's called type. Okay, so this op is actually different. This is a union of these types, and then we have something called op type, which is a union of the types. You know, when I was younger, I didn't really appreciate typed programming languages so much, but I don't know. Even like through coding in Haskell, I didn't really appreciate the power that types had. I guess because I didn't really understand how much bugs cost. Bugs are very, very expensive. So this is an op type here. Great, that fixes that. There's a way to like install the stubs, is there not? MyPy cache somewhere. Install types doesn't work. I can like write some syntax here. Can I not? If it's in the, it's just in the same folder. So does that work? No. Something like that. I don't know how this stuff works. That's a relative import? Okay, that works. some way to like mark an import as missing is okay. Skipped analyzing X, upgrade the version, writing your own stub files, add type ignore. Okay. It's nice to keep that local. Nah, just nobody wrote types for them. Okay. This one doesn't make sense. Oh, that's not a list. Oh, because I did the, I see, the type's wrong because I did the expansion. Cool. Okay. This one, I know what those two are now. That's not that big of a deal. Cannot determine type of buff. Where is buff? Here. I see. I mean, it's this. It's a type. It's a CL buffer. I don't know if that works. Oh, all right. Fails to analyze this. Skipping analyzing that. Module is installed, but missing library stub or pi type D marker. I don't really know what that means. Okay. Need type annotation for loop start. This is just a list of strings. Why can't I put a comma there? We'll add type ignore. I don't really understand why, since that's in my thing. List item 0. Has incompatible type. Here? I put these on different lines. Can you tell me which? Problems here. Wait, what? That's a tuple just for caching, right? tuple optional any. Here's the problem. Optional tuple. Just do that. CL has no attribute CLCTX. It does. That's still wrong. List item 0 has incompatible type. Type signed integer any. Expecting none. Why was it expecting none? Incompatible type. Why? I don't understand that. Creating these two lists. Should I not be writing it like that? Because this is just creating a list of nones, and then it's upset when I have this one. It's like the right input. I don't know. Maybe I should just move it up here. But still gonna complain because I'm doing that in the addition. Fine. I should actually generate that in a smarter way anyway. There is not a smarter way to generate that. The problem is I have to put a type there on that none. Yeah, it's expecting none here because that one's none. There's not really a nice way to fix that. I mean, that API is just so ugly. Oh. MyPy does not support recursive types. Is that still true? Okay, same errors. Function has no attribute forward. This one I can fix. So now let's say I broke this and commented that out. Forward gun unexpected argument stride. Okay. There we go. Oh, there's a Python. You're right, there is. You know what? I was thinking, why did I stream today? And you reminded me why streaming is sometimes worth it. Do I have to import anything for it? Okay, there we go. Cool. So lazy op is very fundamentally cyclical. How many lines did I spend? 7 lines. Is that worth it? Types are always worth it. We should add some more types, actually. CI once we get this to pass. You got a lot of thumbs down for that. Seems to be some basic support for recursive types. Is there a way to do this? So my recursive types are used to define things like ASTs. Type var is, but other people are using them. Huh. Huh. That's a real bug. Oh. Can I do that? Interesting. Wait, no, it totally has those. What are you talking about? Okay, so the type checker wasn't actually working, but what's a type var? Declare a type variable. I see, so I probably want to do inheritance here. I don't know. I don't like any of this. I'm just gonna figure out how to turn this off. How do I turn it off? Now we just have that last stupid one. Is there a better way to write that? I guess I could write it as a comprehension. I mean, there's actually a weird bug there, too. That seems to work. I don't know about that. Someone want to add MyPy to CI? Add some more types here. I was going to complain about those because it's yeah, good. We have more bugs. Cool. Yeah, like here. I messed up this tuple thing everywhere. That's a return from my shape thing that's wrong. Uh, That's definitely correct. That's correct. Incompatible types and assignment. I'm gonna be really excited if we find a real bug. Why is that the variable type? Oh, No, it's not really a real bug. Can I not specify a type here? So it like complains about my comma? That's so frustrating. If I write in the other direction, it should be okay. Problem is types binding to the first type of order. Kind of ugly code in the first place. But cool, we found bugs. Okay. Padding is a tuple of ints. Devices are technically strings. Those don't have to be tensors, that's not right. That's not right either. Oh, never mind, this isn't so easy. I late bind all those classes, so they're not gonna actually be able to be checked. First argument to callable must be a list of types. Ah. Self is always a tensor, it should know that. Those reshapes are broken. Those can either be a number or a so many of them now we're not actually passing in the real type. The problem is they're getting, like, that's getting late bound down here, and that's why that's failing. There is something called COM2D. It just doesn't exist statically. It only exists at compile time. Man, I hate that. Yeah, that's never gonna type check. A lot of these things are never going to type check unless we have stubs like we do for reshape and expand. Yeah, this is why I don't stream tinygrad. I thought we'd do a nice tutorial. You could strike this. It wasn't actually a noob lesson. I said it was going to be a noob lesson, but it wasn't. It just turned into me working on this. I mean, the beginning was kind of a noob lesson. So, you know, we'll call it a half noob lesson. I really don't like that I can't use comma initialization. Yo. Glad he liked it. This CTX is an optional function. See what that does to my file. Yeah. Why does it install torch? No, it does. It locks it to that. It's fixed. That's what fixed the bug. Actually, if you want to figure out why torch 112 is broken, I'm very interested. Wait, you looked at the torch issue? Is there an actual bug in torch? You want a link to the issue? I'm interested. Can't believe we're spending lines on this crap. No, types are worth it. Types are worth it because they reduce bugs. This is going to be a hard thing to get around. I don't like that that's dynamic. I never really did. But yeah, we have this. We have this basically this magic dispatch function that gets applied to the tensor in order to make this work. Yes, I know, Awesome Freak. The problem is functionals cache is only in Python 3.9 and we're supporting back to 3.8. I don't think this is the issue. What? No, it's not an import issue. The Torch 0.112 actually returns the wrong answer. See, it's nice. Now we only put tensors in save for backward. Because you could assume that everything that's not a tensor is small. So that's why I feel okay writing stuff like CTX input shape equals that, because like it's just part of the expand kind of. Elia Hood, my thoughts are you get a timeout. Those are my thoughts. We let non-subscribers talk even when there's only 500 of them. We get that. Low energy stream today. We have types here, and that's what matters. Arg for movement op actually depends on the movement op, which is kind of shitty. I mean, you can just like look at the type structure of something and see where types aren't good. Yeah, I'm gonna try to slowly add back in the optimizer. Like, there's some optimizations that you can do regardless of what you have. Like this merge movement ops is basically free. And remove movement nops is also free. You're a subscriber and you're saying dumb shit like that? Bro. We need a way to like apply shape trackers to NumPy objects. You could just apply the movement ops. Like quickly. This underlying realize function probably should start moving to the devices since oh yeah, you know, you missed the old Drake, man. GPU gem stream, I don't know. I don't know if we're gonna do that one. I don't know, I shouldn't have streamed today. We got pull request from tinygrad. What do we got? Oh, we had MyPy to CI testing. All right, sweet. Thank you. Yeah, if that is good, we will merge that. And then we don't want things to fail MyPy anymore. Yeah, we're gonna have to really, it's really gonna take some work to fit all these optimizations in this stuff. But they start going in there. I sub so I don't get timed out. That's fair. There's a threshold, right? There's like things that anyone can say, there's things that subs can say, and then there's things nobody can say. Alright, let's see if nope. Jonathan's not streaming. We're gonna raid him. Wow, just it's letting the non-subscribers talk makes everybody stupider. Yeah, so we have to figure out how to get the optimizations from here into lazy, and then we have to make sure the optimizations still work on oh, we have two. Well, who did it in less lines? Oh, you have to install MyPy there versus putting MyPy in here. I think it's better here. Do you have a problem that I don't have freedom of speech? What don't I have freedom of speech to say? Can I say the N-word? If I was black, could I say the N-word? That's racist. I don't know. I actually don't know. Are white people allowed to say the N-word on Twitch? Yeah, probably. Then yeah, I guess you have freedom of speech. You ever notice how the bad words change? Like, you know how they put like fuck on TV now, but whoa, there's some bad words now, you know? New bad words, right? Can you? Well, I'm not gonna find out. It's disrespectful, man. It's disrespectful. You hate non-subs. Yeah, dude, you're right. That was a non-sub that said that. You're right, they say the dumbest things. Wow, they're really just like, you know, some people are better than other people. Look, if I can say that, then I think that's what matters. You want me to pip freeze? I have tons of crap. Oh yeah, it runs in 21 milliseconds on the Comma 3. But we have to get the lazy stuff merged, and we have to get the optimizer, and we gotta figure out how to save more lines. Non-subs are real people too, yes, but they're less good people. People with money are usually more smatrar. You're really proving your point, bro. Giving money to Bezos makes you a better person. Does it? Oh, you want to do the GPU matrix multiplication? Eh. There's so much tinygrad to do. Alright, next time we get 1,000 viewers, we'll take the drug test. Remind me about 1,000 viewers. 1,000. It's a good number. $5 of charity. I really am. Dude, whenever I shill for you to subscribe, I'm just shilling for Amazon. Maybe we shouldn't do that.
Bleg Meg Harem. I'm not a Twitch streamer. I don't know how to do any of that. This is a new one for subbing. No, don't give your money to Jeff Bezos, man. Don't subscribe. That's a good point. Whoever brought that up, I think we need to create a subscription. Oh, whoa, this is subversive, man. We need to create a subscription system outside of Twitch where you subscribe. You get a little thing next to your thing, but you don't give Twitch any money. What do you think? Patreon Pro, do I look like a whore? Like, it's only because it's easy and like Twitch just wanted to give me money. I do make like $1,000 a month on Twitch. So it's pretty decent for something. I don't know, for how much effort I put in. Dude, there's people out there like struggling to make money. Twitch banning the idea. Bros, you have freedom of speech on Twitch. I don't know. I like, you know, I could call people Twitch and be like, you're really banning me for this, man. I'm not gonna be like, what's that girl? Alinity. Yeah. If we sub with Prime, we don't take money from Bezos. Don't we take money from Bezos? That's actually a good point. That's actually a good point. Prime subs are the best subs because you're gonna buy Prime anyway. By the way, do you guys know about your Prime sub? I don't even know how to use that. I'm not Prime sub to anybody. Obviously, I buy Prime. Could every single one of you right now who's watching this stream, if you have Amazon Prime, figure out how Prime sub work and then Prime sub to my thing? And that takes money from Jeff Bezos. You, sir, are a genius. You, sir, are a genius. You're a Prime sub. You get mod. That's not how it works. You can't buy your way to mod. Let's go. Next project. Work with some Twitch APIs. Oh, no. I'm going to finish tinygrad. Like, tinygrad is a work of art, guys. If it's... Spend your time reading this code, and you will understand how neural networks work. And, like, it's some of the most beautiful Python code I've ever read also, because I've put so much time into it. Like, it's not that the code itself is beautiful. Like, you can certainly write a lot more comments and make code that's easier to read, but the abstractions are so perfect. Not even all of them. I'm still, my lazy op abstraction still isn't perfect. This one's not perfect because you have to support multiple outputs here. And then my graph needs circles and squares. It's on my board over here. You guys can see my whiteboard. That's tiny grad work. Yeah, DQB, you know, I hate them too, but you're not a sub, so you know what? That's just self-loathing. Heinstein, thank you for subscribing with Prime. Subscribe with Prime and take Jeff Bezos's money. I love it. In 5 years, won't you look back and say it's trash? No, I actually worked on Kira a little yesterday and I was like, damn, this code is pretty good too. What are those books in the back? Oh, these are my books. I don't know. You're not a subscriber. You don't get an answer. You have Prime, bro. I know you have Prime. Just give me your Prime sub. You're not using your Prime sub? Bro. Is it guitar time? Is it guitar time where we talk about how... There we go. Is it guitar time? Where we talk about how... That's first, let's tune the guitar. We gotta tune the guitar. That one always goes out of tune. I hate that string. Alright.
Hot cross buns. Oh, is this gonna get us 1,000 viewers? Do you really want to see me poorly play the guitar? Do I have perfect pitch? No, but I can hear when a note's out of tune. Because I heard the other one. Right? If you ask me just like play one note and tell me is it out of tune, I can't tell you, but. The G string. E, A, D, G, B, E. All right, what should we, what song do we want to play, boys? Can I play Old Drake? Let's see. Best I Ever Had Chords. Does it have chords? I don't know if it has chords. Capo 3rd fret. All right. Baby, you my everything. You all I ever wanted. We could do it real big, bigger than you ever done it. You be up on everything. Other hoes ain't never on it. I want this forever. I swear I could spend whatever on it. Cause she'd hold me down every time I hit her up. When I get right, I promise that we gonna live it up. She make me beg for it till she give it up. I say the same thing every single time. I say you the fucking best. You the fucking best. You the fucking best. You the fucking best. You the best I ever had. Best I ever had. Best I ever had. Best I ever had. I say you the fucking. All right, what are we like? Hotel California. Oh, this is like this requires real guitar skill. A little more so you can see that I'm not faking it. How do I play D minor? We gotta look up D minor. All right, so it's kind of like D, but like this. On a dark desert highway, cool wind in my hair, warm smell of calitas rising up through the air. Ahead in the distance, I saw a shimmering light. My head grew heavy and my sight grew dim. I had to stop for the night. They just stood in the doorway. I heard the mission bell, and I was thinking to myself, this could be heaven or this could be hell. Then she lit up a candle. She showed me the way. There were voices down the corridor. I thought I heard them say, welcome to the Hotel California. Such a lovely place. Such a lovely face. Pretty room at the Hotel California. Any time of year, you can find it here. What do you think? All right. What else we got? What else we got? I'm taking requests. That is equal to the original song? Nah, bro, you're allowed to. Thank you. I've been practicing. I'm glad you guys appreciate Hammer by Nothing Nowhere. Let's see if there's chords for that. No, this isn't really gonna work. It's just two chords. I heard twin size mattress. We can try. Oh, this is like... Oh, what do I have to do? This is a bar chord. F sharp minor? Oh, this is hard.
This is for the snakes and the people they bite, for the friends I've made, for the sleepless nights, for the warning signs I've completely ignored. There's an amount to take, reason to take more. It's no big surprise you turned out this way when they closed their eyes and prayed you'd change, and they cut your hair and they sent you away. You stopped by my house the night you escaped with tears in my eyes. I begged you to stay.
Nah, you said, hey man, I love you, but no fucking way. These chords aren't really right.
Yeah, she hopes I'm cursed forever to sleep on a twin-sized mattress in somebody's attic or basement my whole life. Never graduating up in size to add another. And my nightmares will have nightmares every night. Oh, every night.
All right. No, I'm not good at the Pink Floyd. I don't even know Dire Straits, Sultans of Swing. Now, Hotel California was the highlight of my guitar skills. Iris Goo Goo Dolls. I remember that song. I'm sure that has a good. What? What? I'll try. Oh, I don't know if I can play Never Meant. No, we can't play Taylor Swift. That's copyrighted.
So know that you feel me somehow. You're the closest to heaven that I'll ever be, and I don't want to go home right now. And all I can taste is this moment, and all I can breathe is your life. And sooner or later it's over. I just don't want to miss you tonight. And I don't want the world to see me, cause I don't think that they'd understand. When everything's...
Oh, that B minor to A is hard.
When everything's made to be broken, I just want you to know who I am.
I also switched how I've been playing the A. I used to play the A like this, but it would be muted, so I switched it to this. It takes me longer to get to that position. These chords are not gonna work. Oh, take me home, country roads. All right, now we're talking. Now we're talking the kind of noob shit. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Now we're talking campfire guitar. I can play campfire guitar. They only make they make easy songs.
Breeze, country roads.
D7th? Oh no, that's D major 7th. Home to the place I belong, West Virginia, Mount Mama, take me home, country roads. All my memories gather around her, miner's lady, stranger to blue water. Dark and dusty, painted on the sky, misty taste of moonshine, teardrop in my eye. Country roads, take me home. What else you got? Yeah, through the fire and flames. All right, should we? Bro, I don't even know, bro. Nah, this is too hard. It's too hard. We're gonna try. This is one of my favorite songs. But it's pretty hard to play, so we'll see. Practice more. We're not ready for this yet. But we'll end with Stairway to Heaven. That sounds good. I don't know what E plus is.
It's whispered that soon, if we all call the tune, that the piper will lead us to reason. And a new day will dawn for those who stand long, and the forests will echo with laughter. Actually, a G, that doesn't sound right. It's just a sprinkling for the May Queen. And then this is right between. Yes, there are two paths you can go by, but in the long run, there's still time to change the road you're on. See, I don't know if it's you want it the high one or the low one. Ooh, it makes me wonder. As we wind on down the road, our shadows taller than our soul. There walks a lady we all know, who shines where the light and wants to show how everything still turns to gold. Thank you all for watching today's stream. I appreciate you all being here. Make sure to subscribe to Prime and take Jeff Bezos' money. And we're going to practice guitar. We're going to be better next time. And we're going to get good, and we're going to play this song for you guys, because this is one of my favorite songs of all time. And yeah, we'll do that. Good night. Happy July 4th, everybody. Don't let them take July 4th from you. I'm telling you, man, the Cultural Revolution is afoot, man. The Cultural Revolution is afoot. And they're coming for your Independence Day. They're replacing your American flag with the Pride flag. Fuck it, man. They'll even hang the Ukrainian flag, anything except the stars and stripes. But, you know, this is, nah, man, fuck it. You think I'm attached to that stars and stripes, let's invade Iraq bullshit, man? I love the Cultural Revolution. I love the new overlords. All hail, whoever they are, George Floyd or whatever the saints of the new religion are, man. I'm a Protestant. I'm not a Catholic or whatever the one is, a Sunni, a Shiite, whatever you're the...